ZINSOU, Prime Minister of Benin. Welcome. We've been on a panel now, the panel was just you talking very, very fluently about religion in Africa. If one looks at the situation in West Africa with Boko Haram and so on, how does one solve the tensions and the wars now between, if you like, a Muslim band and a Christian band?
That's a major question and a major enigma for the future. What we can try and do is testify for Benin, because in Benin we encourage, and the president, Bonnier, encourages every kind of inter-religious dialogue. And it's a question of execution of this plan, make far easier in terms of education. Education to all the differences in cultures and religions. For the children, through education, to learn how to respect all and all differences. So it's a question of dialogue, permanent dialogue. It's also a question of the rule of law. In our constitution, the state has to be neutral, but neutral vis-a-vis all religions means respecting them all.
Yes.
Not ignoring them all. And we celebrate all the religions, religious celebrations, Christian, Muslims, and all the ones of the endogenous religions.
The animist traditions of voodoo.
And the animist tradition is especially strong because we are the land of voodoo, the birthplace of voodoo, which is one of the most structured and the strongest of those religions today in Africa.
But if you were advising your counterparts in Nigeria, for example, or Côte d'Ivoire, I mean, Côte d'Ivoire used to be very, very peaceful, and then you had, there was a problem. I mean, what would your advice be? How can they be like Benin, if you like?
It's a bit beyond advice, because it's a question of roots in a long, long history. The way the indigenous religions have accepted and welcomed the Christian missions in the 18th, beginning of 19th century has been very open, because our religions and voodoo were so strong.
Yes.
They were not fearing any threat. And they accepted. And they even offered land to build churches and temples. So it is a long, long story. Then our colonial power in French-speaking Africa has not played with that. When it could well be that the British home rule has played on all the differences, linguistic, all ethnic.
As, for example, in Nigeria.
As in Nigeria. And playing the people against the other people, which has not been the case of the French colonial power, because this idea of the laic state has been projected in Africa. Then
I see what you mean, but surely Côte d'Ivoire is an exception to that.
Then you have another ingredient which is important, which is the fact that the political class has not played on any of those differences. And that's where is the threat. It could change. So it's very, very important, this consensus. And we had that. And in a sense, Ivory Coast had that for many, many years, where it was not a criterion of discrimination to be Muslim or to be. And it's true that the invention of the concept of Ivoirité, are you a real Ivorian?
Yes.
Or are you a bit from Burkina? And if you are Muslim from the very north of Ivory Coast, are you really an Ivorian like all the other ones? The fact that this entered in order to make difficult for one candidate, who is the current president, Alassane Ouattara, to be a candidate and be a president, the fact that this has been a major political tool has really created 12 years of civil war. And that's where it's so important that there be a consensus of the political class. And we had that. And in a sense, we also had that because we had a Marxist revolution for 17, 18 years. And we exited thanks to the President Kérékou, we exited without any bloodbath out of this revolution, with the Archbishop of Cotonou being, in a sense, the man who chaired and created the new democratic social pact, playing an important role. And all that helped with a view that the religious forces, be it indigenous ones, or Christian, or Muslims, were a factor of peace. And this is in our history. So it's very difficult to give any advice, because it's such a delicate balance, yes, which is historical, which is cultural, but which has been colonial, then post-colonial, and then a question of the individual choices of the key leaders. Our leadership is not the strongest in Africa. It's one of the most democratic, but more importantly, it is a peaceful one. If we had a new generation playing on the potential jihadism, yes, of the youth within the Muslim community, and then creating a sort of permanent risk vis-à-vis the Christians, or even the animist, it would be terribly damaging. For the time being, we have not that generation. We could import that.
We keep our fingers crossed, and you're doing very well. You're a regular attendee, a regular participant in the WPC. I mean, what role does the WPC play for you? What do you find important?
The WPC has been one of the first of that kind of geopolitical important forum where leaders have considered two non-that fashionable issues: the importance of the religious facts in geopolitics. That has started day one in Evian, 2008, and Africa. It has been one of the rare conferences where you had a permanent advocacy for the role of Africa. And today, you have the merger of the two issues, because it's true that Islam is now an African religion, and not only a North African religion, because you have now more Muslims in sub-Saharan Africa. And when you look at the demographics of Islam mean it will be an African religion and a sub-Saharan African religion. So anticipating the consequences of that, which has consequences on the economics, basic economy, but more importantly on all the risks of conflict and all the game of influence. Should we look at Maghreb on the west? Should we look on the east to the holy places and other Islam, in effect? Where will be the center of gravity? Will be absolutely key for the world. So the conference has anticipated on those problematics.
Lionel ZINSOU, thank you so much.